Welcome back to the Gridiron Expert. Week 9 proved to be filled with tons of surprises in a week where we were not expecting that much excitement. Yet 11 teams in the top 25 still lost, and 8 of those came to unranked opponents. It was a very wild week in Week 9. As always, we're going to break down kind of the biggest headlines that happened over this past weekend, show our teams trending up and trending down, and give you our recap on how we did on our predictions that we did way back in the summer, and how we did on our spread picks that are always coming out on Twitter, so make sure you're checking those out over at Gridiron Expert. But we'll start with the Friday night game. That was Boston College taking care of Miami in a game that I called back in the preseason. Way back in the summer, I said, I think Miami is going to lose to Boston College. That was their red bandana game, their annual red bandana game on a Friday night. Coming off a bye week, it just felt like the perfect recipe for Boston College to pull off an upset. Now, I don't really know if you can call it an upset anymore because of the way Miami has been playing this season. Of course, we had them trending down, and we'll touch on them in a second. But nonetheless, this was a Miami team that, of course, I missed the mark on. I think I had them going 11-1. They already have 3 losses this year, and I could see them getting another one, 4 or 5 total losses on the year. So a very, very disappointing year for the Hurricanes. But Boston College taking care of Miami at home on a very special night for them, and a game that I got a lot of criticism for. And of course, I'm not going to read any comments today. I'm sure we'll do that here in a couple of weeks as we hit November. But nonetheless, a huge win for the Eagles over the Hurricanes. Clemson, number 2 team in the country, in a game that many thought that Florida State was going to give the Tigers a bit of a fight. They said, no, you know, Florida State has been struggling this year. Willie Taggart has not done what we expected him to do, but with this game being at home, it's an early morning game, maybe Florida State's going to give him a fight, and Clemson just went in there and annihilated them. Trevor Lawrence, as we all know, is the real deal after Kelly Bryant announced that he was going to transfer. They went in there, won 59-10, handing Florida State one of their worst losses in program history. I think it was since 1977, I want to say. So it was one of the worst losses Florida State has ever been handed, losing by 49 to Clemson. And one of the biggest games of the entire week, Georgia taking care of Florida 36-17 in a game that Florida actually led at one point 14-13 on a beautiful pass by Felipe Franks to give the Gators the lead. But then Georgia ran away with it after that, outscoring the Gators by 13 points in the second half to get a 36-17 victory, which is going to lead to a huge game against Kentucky, who, as a matter of fact, had a wild finish of their own this past Saturday. If you watched that game, I would love to hear your comments below. Was that a pass interference call? I do not think it was. I think it was going a little grabbing and pushing on both sides, on Missouri and Kentucky side, and the play should not have never been called for a flag. But nonetheless, Kentucky got one last play on an untimed down and scored a touchdown with no time left on the clock to remain in contention for the SEC East title. And that game, or that division, will be determined this Saturday, November 3rd, going up against Georgia. And Kentucky has the benefit of hosting that game, so I'm very, very excited to watch that one. I think Georgia is going to get the win. We'll talk more on that in the future, but at least Kentucky still has hope. Only has a one-loss team. It technically could be an outside shot for the college football playoff, which rankings come out tonight, this Tuesday. But I'd love to hear your comments. Was it a pass interference call? I do not think it was. Nonetheless, Kentucky got the win, and that's all that matters. California upset Washington 12-10 in a game where the Huskies benched Jake Browning. And what a very disappointing year it's been for Washington. We'll touch on them because they are also trending down on our big board here. But they benched Jake Browning, couldn't get any offensive production going, only mustering up 10 points, and California getting a huge win under their head coach in Wilcox, who's making some big-time strides in year 2. Oklahoma State over Texas. Another game that I got criticized for. I got criticized for it back in the preseason. Got criticized for it back when we did our picks just last week. And I said, you don't want to give Mike Gundy time, especially with an Oklahoma State team that's been so mediocre this season. Nothing like we've seen in the past with James Washington and Mason Rudolph. They still got a solid running back in Justice Hill. But he said, you don't want to give him time to scheme, especially with a primetime game coming up against the 6th-ranked team in the nation. And Oklahoma State jumped out early and never looked back. The score a little closer than the game was, in my opinion, winning that game 38-35. And obviously a very, very wild ending. If you didn't see that, go back and watch the film on that. Some a bit of a scuffle going on between both sides and even involving some of the coaches and Mike Gundy and Tom Herman. But nonetheless, Oklahoma State taking care of Texas, handing the Longhorns their 2nd loss on the year, not eliminating them from the Big 12 title race, but practically eliminating them from the college football playoff race. So a huge win for the Cowboys there, one that we also called. Staying in the Big 12, Kansas getting a huge win over TCU. Now, this game had no implications on any sort of level whatsoever. It's just a big deal because Kansas got a win over a conference opponent. That's something that does not happen very often. TCU, as we all know, having to play a new quarterback after Sean Robinson went down with an injury the same week. They got rid of Kevontae Turpin. getting due to some team policy issues, breaking some rules, stuff like that. He was dismissed from the team. So obviously there's a lot of stuff going around in Gary Patterson and this Horned Frogs team, and that led to a Kansas victory, a 27-26 victory for the Jayhawks. So huge, huge win for them that maybe, if they can snag one or two more wins, could have saved David Beatty's job on the year. And then finally, Arizona defeating Oregon. Not a game that we were really expecting, but I can see why it happened. Oregon coming off a devastating loss to Washington State the week before. Go on the road to Arizona, a team that's very mediocre, below average at best, and they just annihilated the Ducks. And we have Oregon trending down, and we'll talk on a little bit more on them and tell you why we had them doing so. But that was a nightcap there. Arizona just annihilated them. I think it was 44-15 or something like that. It was unbelievable, the performance that Kevin Sumlin and his Wildcats put on the Ducks late Saturday night. So overall, week 9 went 21-13, and we talked on some of these games here about how wild week 9 was, and that obviously contributes to our record that we had here. I go back and I look. I didn't see Kansas beating TCU. I didn't have that one happening at all. I didn't change my Kentucky pick. I had them losing to Missouri back in the offseason. I thought, you know, I said, you know, I could see Missouri pulling off the upset here. It's being at home, Kentucky, Georgia the next week, maybe looking ahead a little bit. I'm not bitter about that pass interference call by any means, but I didn't change that one. So there's Colorado blowing a 28-point lead to Oregon State at home. That's another loss we've got there. So there were just a handful of upsets. Like I said, we had 8 unranked teams beat ranked opponents this week. So a handful of upsets and games that we thought could go either way that just didn't fall our way. But we did go 3-1 in our prediction changes that we put out on Twitter. So that record could have been a little bit worse. But 61.8%, round that up, 62% on the week. Brings our overall to 268-91. So rounding up, that's 75%. Goals to be above 76%, but it's been such a wild year in college football that we might not get there. We'll have to wait and find out. And at the end of the year, we'll compile last year's record plus this year's record and see what we've done over the past 2 years. So obviously, it's going to be pretty big numbers there. 74.7%, 75% if you want to round up for the overall record. Hopefully, entering the final month of the year, final month of the season, all of November, which is going to be wild, we can improve that record just a little bit, crack 300 wins, hopefully stay below 150 losses. That would be the goal. Against the spread this week, a very excellent week. So we didn't really get back on track with the straight-up picks, but definitely got back on track with against the spread, going 6-2, right at 75%, only missing out on 2 games, bringing our overall to 54-41. So if you're rounding that up, that's 57%. And that's, you know, our goal. You know, I've seen some people saying, you know, most legal sports betting sites say it's 55%. That's 500. You got to stay above 55%. Well, we're above it right now. Doesn't matter if we're, you know, 1% above it or, you know, 0.5% above it, we're above it. And that's going to be our goal, is to stay above 500, whether it's right at 500 or 55%, what have you. Our goal is to continue to crank out as many good spread picks as possible. And like I said, all those coming out on Twitter at Gridiron Experts. Make sure you're checking those out. But we are above that, 54-41, and we're usually doing about 8 a week. So make sure you're checking those out there, because we've been fairly consistent for most of the year. Teams trending up. We're going to get into this now. And we're going to start off with Northwestern, a team that had a horrible start to the year, could be ranked, or, like, you know, they could be a little higher ranked right now. And like I said, it's going to depend on how the College Football Playoff Committee looks at them this Tuesday night. But they are the legitimate threat to win the West, the Big Ten West. It's going to happen, I think. I think they have a 2-game lead over everybody. They're 5-1. The next closest person's 3-2, something like that. Northwestern started off the year 1-3. If they could have avoided that loss to Akron, they'd be looking really, really good right now. But nonetheless, they've won 4 straight games, including wins over Michigan State and Wisconsin. Both don't scream powerhouses this year, but Michigan State did just beat a Purdue team that beat Ohio State by 29. And Wisconsin was a nationally ranked team. That was one of the unranked teams beating a ranked team this week, with Northwestern over Wisconsin. They're 1-3, won 4 straight, so they're 5-3. Their toughest games remaining are Notre Dame and Iowa. But they're probably going to have to lose 2 more conference games to get put out of the Big Ten title race or go into the Big Ten championship game. And I don't think that's going to happen. So I think Northwestern, they control their own destiny. They're trending up. When you've won 4 straight games, you certainly deserve it, especially winning some big-time games over some decent opponents. Virginia, 6-2, a team that I know a lot of people have been commenting about it. Of course, I was not high on the Cavaliers at all this season. Was not expecting anything out of them. Expected it to be a bit of a rebuilding year, considering, you know, how good of a year they had last year getting back to the postseason. But they have surprised the heck out of me, and so much so that they might actually win the ACC Coastal Division, which is unbelievable. So a great job by Bronco Mendenhall. They still have to get past Georgia Tech and Virginia Tech, so they can't afford to overlook those two teams. But they're 6-2. They've won 3 straight. They just cracked the rankings in the AP poll at number 23. They beat Duke, they beat Miami, and they beat North Carolina this past Saturday. So things are really trending up. Duke and Miami, not horrible teams by any means. Had a crushing blow to Indiana earlier on the season. I think they lost. I can't remember who it was. Oh, North Carolina State was in a close game there. I think that's correct. So, nonetheless, the Cavaliers looking extremely strong, could win out and could fight for the ACC title, which is unbelievable. It's something that I don't think anybody saw this season, especially with Miami being in that division. And then Houston. This is not very often that you see a group of five team come on to the big board for any reason, whether it's trending up, trending down, biggest game of the week, unless we're doing bowl predictions. But Houston had to come up here. They certainly deserve it. What Major Applewhite has done with this Cougars squad is amazing. They're 7-1. Also contributed to the unranked team being a ranked team, taking care of South Florida. And that was a game that we had on our big board, I believe, this last week, because that was huge just for the American Athletic Conference in general. Houston went in there, took care of business with a 57-36 victory over the Bulls. They are now number 17 in the AP poll. Now, where the playoff committee ranks them, we don't know, but still, they cracked a very high ranking in the AP poll. They are the only team in the country to have scored more 40 points or more in every single game this season. Think about that, 40 points or more. So that offense, extremely dynamic. And, you know, all offseason we talked about how dominant their defense should be, especially with a potential first-round draft pick in Ed Oliver. But the offense has really been cranking out some awesome production. One loss this season was a 14-point loss to Texas Tech in a huge shootout, I think 63-49. So still, put up 49 points on Texas Tech and only lost by 14, so very respectable there. Houston deserves to be trending up, and they are probably the biggest threat to Central Florida in the American Athletic Conference. Now, teams trending down, we talked a lot about these guys when we did our recap just how wild the week was in period. We got Miami sitting at 5-3. Now, 5-3 is not bad. I'm sure many teams out there right now would love to have that record. One went away from bowl eligibility. But this was a year that Miami was supposed to be playoff contenders, a year that they were supposed to get revenge on the ACC, maybe get back to the ACC title game. Could they have beaten Clemson? Who knows? But this year has just been so disappointing. And this is almost like classic Mark Richt. This is what he did back at Georgia. So they're 5-3. I know Miami fans are getting restless, especially with the way they ended last year, the high hopes they had this year. That crushing loss to LSU didn't derail the entire season. It wasn't a conference game. But they've now lost back-to-back to Virginia and Boston College, who are good teams. We just praise Virginia. But they're not your powerhouses. Those are the teams you've got to be, despite both of those being on the road. They still have a game against Georgia Tech, who just went on the road and annihilated Virginia Tech, and also a game against Virginia Tech. I think that game also being on the road for Miami. So there's a chance Miami could lose four games or five games on the year, in a year that they were supposed to be highly ranked and once again competing for the playoffs. So very, very disappointing year for them, coming off back-to-back losses, and it could be more coming soon. Washington, same thing with Miami, a team that was supposed to be college football playoff contenders, and they just haven't gotten the job done. I was praising all offseason. I love Jake Browning. I love Myles Gaskin. I love the defense this season. And here's Washington losing two of their last three, one of those coming to Oregon, who we'll touch on in a second. And just this past week, losing to California, where they could only put up 10 points against a California team that's good but not great. So I've been very, very disappointing. These teams, yes, are trending down, but also when we put teams that are trending down, it's also because they've just been disappointing, period. And this is what these teams have been, just disappointing. They've had high hopes, high expectations. They just couldn't get the job done. And then finally, our last team trending down, Oregon, who has lost two of their last three after beating Washington, saw themselves rise all the way up to number 12 in the rankings, but has lost back-to-back games to Washington State and now Arizona, a game they should have won, a game they got annihilated in, but Arizona not being a good team. So once again, Oregon just being a disappointment. They were number 12 in the country, you know, outside looking in, playoff contender, maybe if they could have won both those games over Washington State and Arizona, and they have just collapsed. So yes, they're 5-3. I believe that is, they're not looking bad by any means. They could still beat some of the mediocre teams in some other conferences, but it's just been a disappointing season for Oregon, especially after the high expectations and the way things were looking. Blowing that huge lead to Stanford, beating Washington, and then just not being able to get the job done against good teams in Washington, and a good team in Washington State and a bad team in Arizona. So a very, very disappointing end for Oregon. Certainly have them trending down. So those are our teams trending up, trending down. How we did in Week 9, Week 10 is going to be even better. November starts this Saturday. This is when things really start to get serious and we start to see how the playoff committee starts to think with the rankings coming out tonight. And this is where things are just going to get wild in college football. These records up here could start to decline, and honestly, I'm not going to care because college football is about to get really, really fun. So make sure you get ready for this Saturday with some huge games. As always, go check us out on Twitter at Gridiron Expert and always here on YouTube. Please continue to like, comment, and subscribe, and we will see you next time on the Gridiron Expert.